Hoy, en Talking Tech, Ana María Llois se encuentra con el físico-químico Loren Mollenkamp para explicarnos cómo se estudian los materiales cuánticos topológicos.
Professor Mollenkamp, it's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you for coming.
My pleasure.
Yeah, and I have just been surfing through the web in order to get some information about you, information that is not in the papers.
Mm-hmm.
And I came upon the fact that you were born in the Netherlands, and in the same decade as me, so that I'm going to call you Lawrence from now on.
That's fine.
Oh, that's fine. Okay. So that you studied in the Netherlands, even you made your PhD in the Netherlands. And one thing that was unexpected for me was that you studied physical chemistry.
Yes.
Yeah. So that was unexpected for me.
Yes.
And the first question is, when was it that physics or chemistry or both came for the first time to your mind as a possibility for your career?
Already as a high school student, I actually was very interested in sciences. And so I figured, yes, that's what I want to do. But actually what I really wanted to go study was biochemistry. And this is how I ended up in the chemistry lab. And then after, it took only a few months before I realized that biochemistry was not what I wanted. And now I could have switched to physics all the way, but actually at that time chemistry in Groningen was a very good place. And so I could do basically the same as the physics students did without losing extra time. And so I figured I stayed in chemistry and then specialized in physical chemistry. But if you look at the classes I took, they're basically the same as the condensed matter physicist. So I already was a physicist then, but basically that saved me some time in changing fields.
At home, also someone in your family, your parents were also had a natural sciences background?
No, nobody really.
Nobody
I was
really.
The first to really be interested in that. Yeah. So my father was a physician, so it is an academic background. But yeah, I'm really the only one who has this interest in sciences. And yeah, well, I mean, you're a physicist yourself. I mean, if you want to do that, it's because you really want to know the basics of something to really go deep. And that's something that I like more and more, the more I saw what you could do. And yeah, that's how I really got into, well, physical chemistry first. And then after my PhD, I joined this research labs of Philips.
I know, that was my second question.
Yes, and there basically I really was turned into a full-time physicist.
And at the time, the first years of in your career were in Philips.
Yes.
And by the way, my first TV set was from Philips. I guess that you were not going
working not
on TV sets on
no.
Not on that. And and when you started in Philips. Did you study in the same area, which was going to be your area after that?
Not directly. That took a while. Philips at the time was something that everybody who had a PhD in physics in Holland wanted to go. It was a bit like Bell Labs in the US. So basically, it was a place where you had a permanent position already, but you could do basic research. At least for a couple of years. Of course, it had to do something, it had to have something to do with Philips, but with their interest, but it was pretty basic, so you could really, it was a great atmosphere also. And then after about 5 years, you could make a choose for the rest of your career, whether you wanted to stay at Philips and then perhaps go more work for a product division, like making a television set, or if you wanted to stay in research, most people then left, and this is what I also did, back to academia, I became a professor somewhere. At Philips or later on?
At Philips,
of course, they put you to work in an area where they thought that you could be of use. I was trained as a spectroscopist, so they first put me working on semiconductor lasers. But then after a while, that group stopped. You have that in the industry, they switch things a lot. And then, of course, I already knew enough physics, also through my young colleagues there, to know where I wanted to work. And that's then I started working on these nanostructures and quantum transport, and these are the things that I actually still do. So that's where I learned this
field. So you remain with semiconductors. Stayed by semiconductors.
Yeah, well, basically it's not that I always have been a semiconductor person, but this is transport physics. Yeah? So basically you can tailor the semiconductor so that you can get the transport effects out that you want. And that's how I basically look at the field. And yeah, I do this with semiconductors because you have so much more control than you have on other materials.
Yeah, it was actually, in the 70s and the 80s, it was usually in Germany and in Europe for students to go into, to make their diploma work in Siemens or in Philips or in these big enterprises. Yeah. Afterwards it's changed, and what happened there?
Yeah, well, basically things did not go so well for these big industries. It's the same as in Bell Labs. Philips Research still exists, but the company is now way smaller and they're not making their own transistors anymore. So this has been made into an independent company, and that means that Philips Research doesn't hire so many people anymore. So in a way, this was great for anybody with a good physics PhD. You could get this job there, and this was fantastic. And now it's way more difficult because, yeah, well, you can still find a lot of jobs in industry, but basically you have to work for the industry. You cannot really play for a while and see whether you're really good at research. And that's the opportunity that we got in those days. But it's mainly because these companies have changed their philosophy. They do not think anymore that they should invest in a big research lab. They basically think that the research should come from universities. And yeah, that means that if you work for a company now, that it's way more applied than it used to be.
I see. And did it happen the same to some others of your Comiliton?
Oh yes, quite a lot of people that I started with at Philips now are professors.
I see. They went to the academia.
A lot of them, yes.
And how is it now? Are the people who are working in the academia or go afterwards to the enterprise, just because of money, I say, because as you said, the research is not being done anymore in the enterprises, no?
No, I don't see that happening a lot. It's usually, well, in Germany, people stay in academia a bit longer. A lot of people can do a postdoc, and then still industry will hire you when you are pushing 40 still. This is very different in Holland. You have to be young to get into industry. So this, I guess, this differs from country to country.
It's different in different countries.
Yes. It's in Germany, industry appreciates if you have a PhD. Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be an extra experience, so it's good for your also for your management experience, and that's why a lot of kids do their PhD in Germany, but then still go to industry. And the other thing in Germany is very hard now to follow an academic career because we have this old-fashioned system where basically you don't have a permanent job until you're associate professor, and you have to move universities between all these promotions, and this is complicated.
The first university you went in Germany was, you had a position in Germany, was the University of Aachen. Mm-hmm. It's a Technical University? No,
it's a Technical University.
Technical University.
Yes. Yep.
And there you started, was it there that you started with the transport measurements, or you came with that from?
I already brought that from Philips. This is why they wanted me there.
Yeah.
And this was a time actually that at Philips a lot of people had to leave because they made you change field. They also, because company was not doing so well, this was the time that things started to go down the drain, so to say, for the research labs. And so basically this is when we started looking for positions. And so Aachen was interested in learning this lithography techniques, also for other materials, and this is how I got to Aachen. Another advantage was that it's a very good university, but the other advantage was also that it was very close by, so I didn't really have to move.
Family was in the neighborhood.
I had a family still in Eindhoven. We had very small kids in those days, and so I was kind of commuting. This was an associate professorship,
You were working with the quantum Hall effect at that time, in the late 80s, no? You had already started?
Yes, the quantum Hall effect was not what we worked on. Mm-hmm. We worked on the quantum point contact, so this was the late 80s. And so yeah, we made these nanostructures which were so small that basically the electrons only scattered at the walls, which is called ballistic transport.
Yeah.
And yeah, so this was something that our group pioneered, and so we were, I think, three experimentalists and a theorist, something like that. And basically, all of us then went our own way in this field. We're still pretty close to this field, but of course everybody has then his own niche where he works. So I ended up first in Aachen because, well, that was an interesting place for me to be. It also did mean that, of course, I got into the German system. I remember I was not a physicist in the Netherlands, so there nobody knew me. And so that's where I was perceived also as a physicist in the academic world, I guess. And it's also, well, if you're an experimentalist, you need a lot of equipment, so you start collecting and you get it from the funding agency of the country you work in.
Yeah.
So that's where I first started to collect my toys, and then I later could take them on to Würzburg. So that's how this all started.
And the people that those who work with you in Aachen moved with you to Würzburg?
Yes, well, this is the German system.
Yeah, I know.
Yes, but they have a choice, of course, but yeah, if they want to keep their job, they have to come along because, yeah, my assistants were really tied to me. With the PhD students, I think most of them we made finish in Aachen, and then only a few that just started we took along to Würzburg, so that was not so bad. But yeah, so in Germany you work with these assistants, which are basically like assistant professors, and they both had to move with
and
me.
And they let you go?
Aachen. But this is the German system again, because I was an associate, and they didn't want to promote me inside of Aachen. That's how I got to move.
You moved your whole laboratory?
Yes.
So nothing remained in Aachen?
Not very much. Some things they bought for me in Aachen from their own money, so they could keep that. But yeah, all my cryostats and stuff, and a lot of the litho I took on to Würzburg. Yeah, that's a major thing. I mean, also moving from Philips to Aachen already was quite something, because I also took stuff from Philips along. And then building a new group up in Würzburg again. It's at least 2 years before you are running again. As a kid, I had many interests, and actually, I tried a couple of them out. So I've been doing archaeology with a society for kids doing archaeology. I've been part of a biology club for kids. And later on, I got into this initiative where you could do research. Well, it was a bit like research at given institutes in town to see whether you like being in the lab. And that's actually where I discovered that this is what I really like best. I want to do research. But as I already indicated, it was biochemistry that I did at the time. I think physics, you can only understand what you can do once you do it for a while. I think at high school, the whole thing is too abstract. And for me, that actually began to grow when I was at university and I saw the kind of things that you can do in a physics experiment. And that made me convinced that I wanted to do that.
Lawrence, you have and had and are going to go on having a rich and multifaceted career. Some time ago, I was attending to a talk by Andy McKenzie, and he said that talk was about electron hydrodynamics. And he said that you had been working, had a pioneering work on that field, and that you have made a big job many years ago.
I was actually at the time I really liked what I found there, but nobody else was very interested.
But
it's a sexy thing.
So you also started paved the way to that
My specialty at Philips was doing thermoelectric stuff in these nanostructures, so that meant heating up the electron system simply by passing a current through. And that's how I also got into the hydrodynamic stuff. But that was the stuff that I did at Philips.
You have been honored many, many times, in the last years after 2007.
Yeah.
because of this breakthrough that you did. What does it mean that you have that you achieved to show the existence of the quantum spill, of that special state of matter, mm-hmm. which is being shown through the quantum spill, spin Hall effect? What does it mean, just hand waving? And then I ask you the next question.
Okay, so what it means is that basically, we found something in the band structure of solids that people overlooked for a very long time. And that is that if the band structure is of a specific manner, you can have a material that is insulating in the middle of the material, but that has a conducting surface state. And this surface state then also has the dispersion that's typical of elementary particles, the Dirac dispersion for the specialists. And that means that we can do all kinds of experiments that mimic high energy physics ideas. So but of course, that's not really how you first do this. The first thing that basically intrigued us was how can we tweak a material such that you can do a quantum Hall experiment at zero magnetic field, because that was originally the prediction. And that led to all these topological materials.
And I mean, they are just a type, that just one manifest. It is the quantum spin Hall effect is just a manifestation of this new or old state of matter mm-hmm. that we
yes.
have just
so
discovered.
This was the first buzzword, and then later on. So once you know that you can have a quantum Hall effect at zero magnetic field, you can also play the trick in higher dimensions. And then the word topological insulator was coined, and that's how these things developed.
We have been working with topological insulators during since the 60s, 70s.
But these materials are well
probably
known.
They were there.
Yes. But you have to get them clean enough to actually see these surface states and to really realize the type of experiments that you can do with them. And in our case, we had this mercury telluride, and so that is a very clean material, and so you can show these things without too much of trouble. And other things is, if you want to see the surface state in things like photoelectron spectroscopy, you need to have a good tool to do it. And this is where the ARPES people came along, who actually at that time had these nice tools. And so, these materials have been worked on. Also in my lab by my predecessor and his people, they worked a lot on narrow gap materials, and there's quite a few of these narrow gaps that have band inversion. Yeah. And so these effects are partly known, but that this is really a truly new state of matter, and that these surface states are topologically protected, that's something that wasn't realized.
How would you explain to the audience also what does it mean topologically protected?
It's a big word. It's basically it's a new type of quantum number that you can induce if you have a very specific type of band structure that you cannot really undo. But the physics is really simple. You have an S and a P orbital. Usually the P has an higher energy, but the materials such as ours, they're switched. And then, of course, you have to connect these S and P states somewhere at a place where, as you can say, topology changes. And you can just draw a cross, and that's how they connect, and that's your surface state.
And that's
all it is, yes.
And implications, technological implications?
This is what people
This is a question.
There is a somewhat higher mobility in these materials. Whether this is going to really weigh against all the problems you have in processing them is a very good question. A lot of the physics is very interesting that you can do with these materials, and there may be applications in superconductivity that you induce in it. There may be topological quantum computing. But this is also all a lot of buzzwords that are good for getting the money in, and whether they really will lead to applications is an open question.
Yeah. But probably not always. Not everything was successful.
No, nothing works. Not everything works, of course. You try out lots of things, and these few things, these work very nicely. It turned out that indeed the Würzburg materials were very good for doing spintronics. And like I said, the Merck telluride the quantum spin hole stuff, the topological stuff, yeah, that was totally unexpected. But I did get the things out that I wanted to do in spin orbit. That also worked. So you can have some idea what you want to do. That can already be quite decent physics. I mean, really big hits like this topological material, that you cannot foretell. That just comes.
And in view of that, and of your experience, and okay, really a good experience in research, which would be an advice for students who are starting or finishing now their diploma?
So what helped me a lot is what people don't really like is change fields a little bit every now and then. At least in the beginning of my career, I did that a lot. Yeah, first from optics to semiconductor optics, and then from semiconductor optics to semiconductor transport, and then apply it to other materials. And then in the end, if you've seen a lot of physics, you can combine things and you can do something new. Yeah. And that takes time, and you have to be patient, but for me it worked very nicely.
Thank you very much for this interview. It was a pleasure, I enjoyed it a lot.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It was also for me a very nice thing to experience. Thank you.